Hello everyone, this is Dr. Ritvik and I would like to talk about casting effects. And why in specific I have chosen this topic is because when I myself was in second year, I never used to understand this topic and most of it was like Greek and Latin to me. Because by the end of first year, all what we knew was about root length, crown length, eruption and shedding pattern of the teeth. And if you were supposed to be a topo kiddo, then you might be knowing about the enamel dentin, its composition defects and all. And suddenly when we enter into the second year, you come across the terms like RPD, short span bridges, long span bridges and all. And I was like, seriously? What role does a dentist have in constructing a bridge? It was supposed to be a job of a civil engineer, right? And later at the end of second year, when I came to know the original meaning of a bridge, I felt very lame about me thinking in that way. Anyways, because casting defects is a very volatile and important topic for both second years and final years, and also an important topic for PG entrance exams, I thought it would be better if I take up this topic. So without any further ado, let's get into the topic. So the basic classification of casting defects. So casting defects can be classified into four major types. And what are the four major types are? Number one is distortion of the casting. Number two is surface roughness. Number three is porosity. This is the area where most of the students get confused. Don't worry, let's get into very details of porosity. And number four is the incomplete casting or the missing details. So distortion, surface roughness, porosity and incomplete casting or missing detail is a basic classification of the casting defects. So the first one is the distortion. What is distortion? Distortion is nothing but your final cast restoration does not match the tooth preparation that you have done for casting. So your final restoration does not match the tooth preparation what you have done for the cast restoration, and this depends on two factors. This distortion or the final cast restoration not matching the tooth preparation depends on two factors. The first factor would be the wax itself, the wax which is used to make the wax pattern. And why? What is happening is, like every creature and everything in the planet has a little memory with it, this investment wax also has a memory. Of course, a memory which is way better than what I have. So, if the wax pattern gets distorted, then final cast restoration will also get distorted. And why? Why this distortion occurs? It is because, as I told you, the wax has a memory. And also, while preparing the wax pattern, if you introduce the wax to sudden variation of temperatures, what will happen? So sudden build of temperatures will lead to increase in the stress within the wax. First, suppose the original pattern of wax is this. And while preparing the wax pattern, you have bent your wax pattern in this way, but in increased stress, increased temperature, so you are increasing the stress within the wax pattern. So what happens if you doesn't immediately invest this wax pattern? Suddenly the wax will remember that, no, this is not my shape. I am supposed to be into my original shape. And what does this happen is, it will come back to its original position, leading to distortion. You wanted your wax pattern to be in this shape. But what wax pattern does, because you are delaying due to increased buildup of stress, it will try to lose its stress and come back to its original position. So, what do you do to prevent this wax distortion? It is nothing but you invest the wax pattern as soon as possible and also not subject the wax pattern to lot of temperature changes. As the first reason is wax itself, so what is the second reason? Second reason is the investment. So, what material do we use for casting? Of course, it is a metal. And what property does a metal have? metal have an inherent property that upon cooling and upon solidifying it shrinks. So we can't accept any shrinkage with our casting, because we have already set a limited dimensions, and any deviation from that dimension would not fit into the patient's mouth or would not fit onto the patient's prepared tooth. So we doesn't want any shrinkage. So to compensate for the shrinkage of this melted or solidified metal, what we do is we have to expand the mold. So as a process of expansion, what happens in any wax pattern, there would be a very thick portion and a thin portion at the cervical regions, because cervical regions generally the wax pattern is very thin. So while expansion of the mold, the thick regions, they resist the expansion, while the thin regions, they doesn't resist to this expansion of the mold. But luckily, this distortion is very minimal. This distortion is very minimal, so we don't have to do any corrections to overcome this distortion. So the second most common casting defect is the surface roughness and irregularities. So actually, surface roughness and irregularities is the most common and major casting defect which can be seen. So what is the difference between surface roughness and surface irregularities? So if this is supposed to be your casting, generalized defect is your surface roughness. So surface roughness is your generalized defect. It is present in general throughout the casting. And what is surface irregularity? Surface irregularity is the isolated defect. Surface irregularity is an isolated defect, and surface roughness is your generalized defect. And why? Why does we see surface roughness and surface irregularities? Before we get into why the surface roughness and surface irregularities occur, let's first talk about what should we do if surface irregularities and surface roughness occurs. Because as we talked that it is a most common and major defect, and somehow how perfectly you do, you get some surface roughness or irregularity. So to what you have to do if you already have got surface roughness and irregularities is nothing but keep polishing. Just sit and finish and polish more. If you have more surface roughness, polish it more. That's it. There is no other solution for it. But we can prevent surface roughness, higher extent of surface roughness and irregularities, by knowing what are the causes of these surface roughness and irregularities. So let us get into the causes of surface roughness and irregularities. So the first cause is the presence of a little air bubbles while you are investing. So these little air bubbles generally get entrapped while investing, and that might lead to surface roughness and irregularity. So what you have to do to avoid these air bubbles is simply invest under vacuum. So if you invest under vacuum, you can escape from these minor little air bubbles and you can get a neat, precise casting. What is the second reason? Second reason is water films. Generally, the wax and water are hydrophobic. They have been enemies since generation. They don't generally mix together. So a little water film residue remains over the wax pattern. And when this is invested, that will come up as a surface roughness or irregularity. So to avoid this thin water film layer on the wax pattern, what you have to do is you have to apply a wetting agent all over the wax pattern. So there is uniform application of investing material all over the wax pattern. So you add a wetting agent. Another reason for surface roughness and irregularities is rapid or prolonged heating. What happens when you heat for a long time, or you suddenly rapidly heat for a very high temperature? What happens? There is either steam production or either there is crack formation. Steam, where does it produce from? It produces from the water present in the investment. So the steam production will lead to your surface roughness, and crack production will lead to your irregularity formation. And also sometimes on heavy heating, there might be the release of sulfur, which causes surface roughness again. So in order to prevent this, what you have to do? For suppose you are using a gypsum bonded investment material. Gypsum bonded investment material should only be heated up to 700 degrees. So what you have to do is, you have to bring from room temperature to 700 degrees centigrade in 60 minutes. Not less than 60 minutes. If you heat less than 60 minutes, that would be again rapid heating to 700 degrees centigrade, and that will lead to steam and crack formation. So from room temperature to 700 degrees centigrade, you have to take in a stipulated time, that is 60 minutes. Then you can avoid these surface steam production, crack formation, and that ultimately will avoid surface roughness and irregularity formation. And also, not only overheating, underheating might also cause surface roughness and irregularities. How? Underheating will cause, what would underheating cause? Underheating would cause wax residues or gas inclusions, or gas may remain within the casting. Gas may remain within, and so that will again will lead to surface roughness and irregularities. So the next cause that would cause surface roughness and irregularities is alloy temperature, pressure, or speed at which the metal is forced into the mold space. So if at all the molten metal is forced at a very high speed into the mold space. Suppose this is the mold space, and a molten alloy is forced at a very high speed through the sprue created space into the mold space, that would go directly and hit the bottom. Because the alloy has been forced with a very high speed, it would directly go and hit at the bottom. And at this speed, when the molten alloy goes and hits at the bottom, it would create a crack in the investment, and that would again will lead to irregularity and surface roughness. So in order to prevent this, what you do, it is simple. You select the molten metal alloy's temperature and also the speed with which you are forcing the molten metal alloy into the mold space. And also, what could be the other reasons for surface roughness and irregularities is the consistency of the investment you use. If the investment you use is rough, you would definitely get a rough casting. If your investment material is smooth, you will get a smooth casting with a good and precise finish. Next thing is the pattern position. The pattern position, or when you first, suppose you are using multiple patterns at the same time, and you do it in such a way that all the patterns are at the same level. All the patterns are at the same level. When all the patterns are at the same level, this will prevent or resist the expansion of the mold. So the mold wouldn't expand in this area. So there will be resistance to expansion. In order to prevent this, what you do is, you have to place your multiple patterns at different positions. At different positions, you have to place your patterns at different levels. So in order to prevent this defect that you get from placing the patterns at the same level. And what could the other reasons be? The other reasons be could be the carbon inclusions, could be using the reused metal, improper pickling, and also your metal getting contaminated with the mercury. These could be the other reasons for surface roughness and irregularities. Now let's talk about the most confusing aspect of the casting defects, that is the porosity. Porosity seems to be very confusing to most of the students. Let us talk about porosity in the most simple way possible. So what is a porosity actually? porosity is the localized area which is devoid of the metal. Means there is no metal in certain area of the casting. So porosity can be of two types. It is either an external porosity or internal porosity. External porosity are manifested externally. For internal porosity to see, you have to cut open the casting and then you can see the internal porosity, or else you can't see the internal porosity. So the porosity is based on the types, means based on the, you can say, etiology. It's not a disease anyways, but based on the how it has occurred, we can classify porosities into three types. That is the solidification shrinkage porosity. Porosity is caused due to absorbed gases, and porosities that are caused due to air entrapment. So first let us talk about the solidification shrinkage type of porosity. Generally, any metal used for casting shrinks at the rate of 1.25%. So any metal which we use for casting will arbitrarily shrink around 1.25%. So shrinkage is a very common phenomenon for a casting metal. So how this shrinkage could cause porosity? The first type of solidification shrinkage porosity is the localized shrinkage porosity, and it's an internal porosity. So in order to look at this porosity, you need to cut open the casting and then only you can find the localized shrinkage porosity. Now why does this localized shrinkage porosity occur? Let us get into it. When a molten alloy flows into the casting space, it first fills the extreme parts. So as a part of tradition, generally the metal will shrink. But to compensate the shrinkage at these extreme parts, there is continuous supply of the metal from the sprue space. So the metal shrinkage is compensated in these extremities part of the casting. But when the flow of metal stops, what happens to this place? This is the last place to cool. The junction of the casting and the sprues is the last place to cool. And when this cools, there is no external supply of the metal. So this part of the metal shrinks, causing localized shrinkage porosity. And this is an internal type of porosity. And how do you prevent this localized shrinkage porosity is, you either increase the diameter of the sprues, you either increase the length of the sprues so that more metal stays in. Or very important thing is, you add a reservoir. So that even after the flow of metal is stopped, some amount of molten metal stays so that it supplies the molten metal even to this area, so that there is no localized shrinkage porosity occurring. So you prevent by increasing the diameter of sprues, increase the length of the sprues, or using a reservoir, or you can even increase the mold temperature so that the metal in this area stays molten for some time to supply the molten metal to this junctional area, so that localized shrinkage porosity is prevented. So this is a localized shrinkage porosity. And there is also another variant of this localized shrinkage porosity that is called hot spot or suck back porosity. Why does this type of porosity occur? Whenever you place your sprues in 90 degrees to the long axis of the teeth, then the molten alloys directly goes and hits at this extreme part. And when the molten alloy stops flowing, this will be the last part to shrink. Because until the molten alloy is continuous, there is continuous flow of alloy, and for all the remaining parts of the casting, there is continuous flow of the alloy. And when you suddenly stop the flow of metal, this part would be the last part to shrink. And shrinking at this area is called as hot spot or suck back porosity. And this porosity is seen externally. How do you prevent this porosity? This porosity is prevented by placing a spruce at certain angulation other than 90 degrees. So you place your spruce in this way, not in a 90 degrees, so that the molten metal alloy is equally distributed. So you place your spruce at certain angulation. So we have completed with localized shrinkage porosity and a type of localized shrinkage porosity, which is a hot spot or suckback porosity. Now another type of porosity is the microporosity. So this is microporosity. So let us get into the micro level. So generally there are metal grains and micro voids present in a normal condition. Generally there are metal grains in a molten alloy. When we are talking about molten alloy contains metal grains with some micro voids present in them. In a normal condition, when these metal grains cool down, they shrink. Generally metal cool down and the metal grains shrink and they come together and they expel the micro voids outside. So the air is being escaped. So micro voids comes outside of the metal surface and there is no any shrinkage seen. But when the cooling process takes place very faster, there is no sufficient time for these micro voids to escape from these metal grains, and metal grains come together very fast such that the micro voids get entrapped between the metal grains. That will lead to formation of the porosity, and this type of porosity is called as microporosity. And how do you prevent this microporosity is you give sufficient time for the voids to come out. How do you give sufficient time for the voids to come out? You increase the mold temperature so that the metal stays molten for a longer period of time without shrinking very fastly and allowing sufficient time for the voids to go out, so that microporosity is being prevented. So the second type of porosities are caused due to the absorbed gases. So what are the three types of porosities that are caused due to absorbed gases are the pinhole porosity, the gas inclusion porosity, and the subsurface porosity, of which pinhole and gas inclusions are both are similar type of porosities, except the difference is the gas inclusion porosities are of bigger size porosity. So why does this pinhole porosity occur? The first one, generally the molten metal that we use generally contains copper and silver, and copper and silver are always in love with oxygen. I mean, they have higher affinity to oxygen, so they have higher amounts of dissolved oxygen in them. So when this molten metal alloy containing copper and silver with dissolved oxygen in it is entered into the mold space, and when this cools down, it starts to release the oxygen outside. Now, in general conditions, if at all it has a normal space, the oxygen will escape outside. But this is surrounded by investment material, so there is no place for the oxygen to escape outside. So it will form porosities, which are very minute, the size of oxygen, a small oxygen bubble. So very minute porosities. These are called pinhole porosities. They are almost the size of a pinhole. That's why they got the name pinhole porosity. This is how pinhole porosity occur. And pinhole porosity is generally due to dissolved gases in the molten metal. What is gas inclusion porosities? Where is this inclusion of the gas? There is already gas present. Air is present in the mold space even before the entry of the molten metal. There is some amount of air present in the mold space, which when molten metal alloy enters into the mold space, get mixed up with this gas and slowly gets expelled when it starts to cool down, causing gas inclusion porosity. So both are similar types of porosities caused due to absorption of gases within the mold with the molten metal. But pinhole porosity, there is already dissolved gas in the molten metal, whereas gas inclusion porosity, the gases are already present in the mold space, and when the molten metal alloy enters into the mold space, then it gets mixed up with the gases. So this is how pinhole and gas incursion porosities occur. Then what is this third type, that is the subsurface porosity? The name itself tells that the porosities are not present on the surface, but they are present just beneath the surface. That is the subsurface porosity. As we talked that the molten metal alloy is mixed with the gas, I mean air. So when it cools down very rapidly, not even in such a rapid way that even the molten metal doesn't get enough time to escape outside, the top layer of the metal gets cooled down and solidified. So the air doesn't have enough time to even escape from this. So it gets collected beneath the surface, causing the subsurface porosity. And there is one and only thing that you can do to prevent all these type of porosities is use the reducing flame to heat the molten alloy. When you use the reducing flame, the contamination with oxygen decreases so less that you will get only very minute amounts of such porosities. So when to prevent absorbed gases porosities, use a reducing flame. So a little concept here. Generally, this, suppose this is a mold space and air is present in the mold space. If the metal is forced into this mold space, air should escape out. Air should escape out. In most of the situations, why does this air doesn't escape out is because the distance from the casting end to end of the ring. If you keep this distance more than 6.5 mm, there will not be sufficient pressure to push the air outside this casting. So the air remains within the casting and that will cause to adsorbed gases porosity. So the best thing is that you at least place a minimum of 6.5 mm distance from the casting, end of the casting to tip of the casting ring. This is how you prevent the porosities caused due to absorbed gases. Now coming to the final type of casting defect, that is the incomplete casting. So incomplete casting means there is no complete desired casting. A part of the casting is missing. And why does this occur? There are two reasons for why incomplete casting occurs. That is, first one is incomplete burnout, and second one is because of inherent properties of the metal that you use. Incomplete burnout. So what happens when there is wax residue left over? When the molten alloy comes and gets in contact with the wax residue, it will combust immediately and produce carbon monoxide gas. And this carbon monoxide gas produced will not allow the molten metal to reach this space. It will keep pushing the molten metal alloy, carbon monoxide gas. And how do you identify that this is the incomplete casting occurred due to incomplete burnout? Is it will have a shiny surface. This margin of metal will have a very shiny surface because of reducing property of carbon monoxide. So this is how you identify a incomplete casting that is caused due to incomplete burnout. The second property is because of metal inherent properties. If at all you choose a metal which has high viscosity, low density, then that would not completely fill the mold space. Or even if you do not provide sufficient pressure to push the metal into the mold space, that will even cause the incomplete casting. For example, take the type 4 metal, which is base metal alloys. They have comparatively decreased low density. When density is reduced, you can't expect the metal to completely go and fill the mold space. Unless you are providing a high pressure, that's a different story. So base metal comparative to type 4 metals, that is the noble metals, have decreased density. So they do not completely fill the mold space. That even causes incomplete casting. And how do you identify the incomplete casting due to some problem in the metal properties? Is they will have probably rounded margins. So incomplete burnout will have shiny surface, and incomplete casting caused due to the metal properties will have rounded margins. So these is the casting defects. I hope I made the casting defects a little bit clear to you. So this is all with the casting defects, and thank you for bearing with me this long. Signing off, Dr. Ruthvik.